one mandatory challenger, Yanni Perez. Born in Colombia, living in Santa Fe Springs, California. Comes off the biggest win of his career. Down on the cards in round 12, he dramatically stopped the formidable Silence Mabuza on enemy ground in South Africa. And Al, he handled the pressure of Mabuza, but tonight he steps up to a different level.
Yeah, you know, he's fought all over the world in top amateur competitions during a long amateur career, and as you said, he got through the Mabuza fight on foreign soil, but there's always a question when a fighter is in his first title match. He calls this his dream come true. Keeping his poise in this match will help keep it a dream and not a nightmare.
He's a little older than Agbeko, but only 19 pro fights to Agbeko's 28, but 247 amateur bouts, several national titles. Will that experience help Yanni Perez in his first world title shot and the biggest fight of his life? Perez believes the large 24-foot ring, by the way, will serve him better. He wants to fight outside, and he feels that the extra space will allow him to establish distance. Well, what would Halloween be without Fay Wray and King Kong, Al?
I love these recreations, really.
Joseph King Kong Agbeko with a Halloween-themed ring entrance. And perhaps fitting, as he promises a very scary night for Yanni Perez. When Agbeko upset the feared Victor Chinian, he didn't just win, he beat him up. That performance vaulted Agbeko into boxing's global spotlight. Very hard to take this seriously, by the way.
Where is Fay Wray when you need her? That's what I want to ask.
I'm just forging ahead here. But tonight, of course, begs the question, what will he do for an encore? We shall see. This has to be one of the more unusual ring walks, Halloween or no Halloween.
I think it ranks in the top 10, certainly, that I've ever seen. And I don't know. Not everyone may appreciate it.
He's a guy who brings a great spirit and passion to the sport, much like his idol and countryman, the great Azuma Nelson. And, he's got a good sense of humor. Joseph Agbeko, a long road from Accra, Ghana to the Bronx, New York.
And of course, his name, needless to say, is King Kong, and that's the whole point of this. But
Nickname.
Yeah, it's not his real name. His actual name, so that's part of the whole shtick here. And
it's on his birth certificate and passport. All right, let's check the numbers as we go to the tail of the tape. And of note here, height and reach advantage Perez, particularly the reach. Agbeko not used to that in his last few fights. And again, Al, the replay rule.
For the first time ever anywhere here in Nevada, referee Robert Byrd, you see him there, has the right to do a replay, an instant replay. If he stops a fight due to injury, he can review the replay to see if the injury was from a legal blow or a foul. He has that option to make sure he's made the right call and he can reverse his decision or make one.
And here is Joseph King Kong Agbeko San's mask. His only loss in 28 fights back in 2004, a majority decision to Vladimir Sidorenko. He's bounced back with 7 straight wins. So here at Treasure Island in Las Vegas, getting ready for our main event, Joseph King Kong Agbeko versus Yanni Perez for the IBF Bantamweight Championship. We are set for the official introductions from our ring announcer, the classy Jimmy Lennon Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you and welcome to Phil Ruffin's Treasure Island Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada for the featured bout of the evening brought to you by Don King Productions and Treasure Island in association with Gary Shaw Productions, Thompson Boxing Promotions, and Showtime. This bout is sanctioned by the IBF. President Marion Muhammad, Supervisor Mahasan Scott, along with the Nevada State Athletic Commission, the chairman Bill Brady, commissioners Kip Avancino Jr., John Bailey, TJ Day, and Pat Lundvall, with the executive director Keith Kaiser. Our physicians at ringside, Dr. Anthony Ruggieroli, Dr. Stephen Brown, Dr. William Berliner, and Dr. Michael Gunter. Introducing our timekeepers at the bell, also keeping count of the knockdowns, we have Jim Cavan and Ernie Haurigi. Our three judges scoring this bout from ringside. From Bellevue, Washington, Barry Druxman. From Las Vegas, Nevada, Jerry Roth. And also from Las Vegas, Glenn Trowbridge. Introducing our referee in charge of this bout. He'll be giving instructions after the introductions. From Las Vegas, Robert Bird. All right, fans, here we go with our main event of the evening. 12 rounds of boxing for the IBF Bantamweight Championship of the World. And now, ladies and gentlemen in attendance, and boxing fans joining us around the world, live from Treasure Island in Las Vegas, it's showtime! Introducing to you first the challenger on my left, fighting out of the blue corner. Wearing white trunks trimmed to the colors of the Colombian flag, he is fighting out of Santa Fe Springs, California, by way of Cartagena, Colombia. He weighed in at the bantamweight limit of 118 pounds. He is undefeated in his campaign to the ring with a record of 19 wins, no losses, 14 wins coming by way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, here he is, the IBF number one ranked contender, known as El Colombiano, Yoni Perez.
Every get down.
And his opponent across the ring, the defending world champion. On my right, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black trunks with silver trim, fighting out of Bronx, New York, by way of Accra, Ghana. He weighed in the same as his opponent, 118 pounds even. His record stands at 27 wins, one loss, 22 wins coming by way of knockout. Tonight, making the third defense of his title, here is the IBF Bantamweight Champion of the World, introducing Joseph King Kong Agbeko. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, a referee in charge now to give instructions, Robert Bird.
Take your cue from Joel at ringside, right?
I got it. Need one. Okay, gentlemen, I gave you instructions in the dressing room. The only thing I'm going to remind you of now is when I say stop, when I habla pare, that's what I want you to do. Stop whatever you're doing. Give me a clean break. Fuera limpio. Okay, protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands at all times. Let's do it.
Good luck.
As the fans gear up in the cozy ballroom at Treasure Island, the champion Joseph Agbeko, good slick boxer who can punch relentlessly, 22 of his 27 wins by KO, confident that Perez will be knockout number 23. Perez, a tall bantamweight who can box or slug, 14 of his 19 wins by knockout. Major opportunity to make a huge statement with an upset tonight.
Back up. And we might mention that while obviously they were trying to make a some kind of transition to the King Kong movie with that walk-in, there were certainly elements of that that we understand could well be a bit offensive to folks, and the movie Halloween theme didn't quite play out as everyone would like it, in my opinion, and so clearly we want to point out that we were not a part of that. We were not a part of that walk-in, and that came from the promotional company.
Stop.
All right, round one scheduled for 12 for the IBF Bantamweight Championship. A quick early cautioning by Robert Bird about the heads of Joseph Agbeko, who does have a tendency to come in with his head. And the handlers of Yanni Perez, who also handled Victor Chinian, extremely concerned about that. Some pretty good action here at the outset as both are winging. Perez very different from Agbeko's recent opponents. As Al mentioned, he's the first righty Agbeko has fought in over 2 years. And Agbeko's last three opponents were straight-ahead brawlers. This guy, Perez, is a mobile counterpuncher.
Yeah, the problem is he's not fighting that way. He is laying on the inside with Agbeko. He sometimes does that, does Yanni Perez. And when he does, it's not good for him. And in this fight, he cannot afford to stand there and wing right hands, I don't think, with Agbeko.
You're right. He's fighting Agbeko's fight, which is what Agbeko wants. And that could be to the detriment of Perez.
Now, differentiated from the first fight where DeMarco did exactly what was right for him and we didn't end up with such an exciting fight. This one is going to be exciting even if Yanni Perez is making a mistake.
Yes, the elements of a very entertaining headline fight. Well, Perez handled the pressure of Silence Mabuza. Can he stand up to the stronger, tougher, more skilled Agbeko? Perez is bigger, he's busier than Garchinian was against Agbeko, and they just keep flinging.
And you know, Perez is not a left hook artist, but that left hook's available to him, and he's throwing it very well. So I hearken back, though you don't ever expect any fight to be that good, but I hearken back to Diego Corrales and Jose Luis Castillo. And Steve, remember when we did that fight? We said early, oh my goodness, Diego Corrales fighting the wrong fight, laying on the inside. And yet he was able to do what Perez is kind of doing in portions here, fight well on the inside.
Agbeko, relentless, Al. He just has not let up since the opening bell, and he just feels Perez will not be able to take his punches for 12 rounds.
There's another nice hook by Perez. He surprises me with that punch in this fight.
And that stopped Agbeko momentarily. Another one right on the chin of Agbeko. Perez is landing.
Got a bell coming.
Another left hook by Perez on the chin. Let's get to the keys of victory. Keys to victory, Al.
Well, for Perez, he sometimes leans in and he needs to use his height and reach. He didn't do that in the first round, but we'll see. And he often voluntarily pushes himself to the ropes. Not a good idea in this fight. Agbeko can be hit with a counter right. We saw that right at the end of the round when he often lunges in Agbeko. For Joseph Agbeko, if he lunges in to throw the right, Perez will counter him, so he can't do that. With his hands low, which they often are, Agbeko relies on good head movement for defense. He has a powerful and accurate right hand. He's got to throw it early and often, and boy, he did in round one. Early in the round, Joseph Agbeko taking advantage, and there's the right, of Perez fighting on the inside, going to the body and the head. But later on in the round, Perez was landing some very sharp punches and working very well on the inside with the right hand and the left. So this has the makings of a superb fight.
Tell you what, Perez not afraid to get inside with Agbeko, and usually that's flirting with danger against a guy like Agbeko with those sharp, accurate right hands and the good left hook. Agbeko leans in. Let's see if Perez can take advantage of an uppercut as the nonstop punching continues. I mean, it has been sustained from the opening bell. Look at this exchange. Perez is winning it.
The hand speed and right hand of Perez are winning the day at the moment, but that only lasts for maybe a 20-second period, and Agbeko can easily come back.
Perez with a terrific left hand, the jab on the hook. We're seeing it. And watch out for Agbeko's right, as Al pointed out. Beautiful combination upstairs by Perez. He sends Agbeko back.
Both men are landing peak punches early.
Non-stop give and take back and forth. Terrific action.
And you know, just a little lateral movement from Perez makes a difference. When he does move a little side to side, the left hook of Perez, that's the shocker in this fight.
And he continues to pour it on. See, a lot of Agbeko shots are being blocked. Perez's punches are getting through.
Neither man has ever been down as a pro. What do you think? I mean, is that gonna last through tonight?
Yeah, Agbeko, pro or amateur, never down. Perez in the pros, and Perez with 247 amateur fights, down a couple of times in the amateurs, but never as a pro.
I think we can forgive that, huh?
Yeah, we'll let that slide. Oh, right hand by Agbeko. Countering right, not as effective by Perez.
Does this... Perez doing so well, fighting this way, and he pushes Agbeko back. That's a news story, let me tell you. You don't do that very often.
I think he's surprised Agbeko. Oh, he didn't expect this, Al.
In a big way, Steve. And what kind of statement does it make to Agbeko? Will it shake his confidence at all?
There's a left hook to the head by Perez. The lanky Yanni Perez smoking here in the first two.
You know, sometimes we watch these films of the fighter and we try to handicap what they're going to do. I will tell you, the thing I missed was the left hook of Perez. I never saw it look as good as it is in this fight.
Good straight right hand, got through by Agbeko, missing with the next right and a left. Heading for the bell.
Time!
The sizzler.
Relax. Come on. Relax. No more. Let him relax. I don't miss in your pocket. I go home. Yes.
Then relax.
No
breathe
more.
Breathe in.
Early in that round, Perez backing up Agbeko. That right and left hook were as strong a punch as you can land. It shows you the chin Agbeko has, but for one of the few times you see him go back with an avalanche of punches from Perez. Later in the round, though, this right hand gets in by Agbeko. It's his best punch. It's a powerful punch, and that sends a message to Perez as you see him back up.
That was a great expression by Perez. What was that?
Yikes.
This the type of action you'd hope for in a matchup of the champion and the number one challenger. Agbeko, all action fighter, who punches and keeps punching, as we said at the open of the telecast, and he has not disappointed.
Now, they were very worried, Perez's people, about Agbeko using... Oh, nice combos by Agbeko. He's going to start, I think, trying to throw more combinations. They were worried about the head of Agbeko. He tends to use it on the inside. They felt he did that against Archinian. But Perez is fighting on the inside with him and not worrying about that. Oh.
They continue to trade bombs. Left hook by Agbeko. Sometimes that left hook is wide. Got a good straight right in there. Right hand by Agbeko. Left hook by Perez. Back and forth, nonstop. Can these guys do this for 12 rounds? We'll find out.
It's an amazing pace. I mentioned Castillo Corrales. The Vasquez Marquez trilogy felt like this. Trilogy felt like this as well.
It's like a video game, Al.
And it's not just that they're big punches. The volume of punches is pretty extraordinary in his first three rounds.
Big long right hand that tagged Agbeko. What a right that was by Perez.
The only difference in this fight, to me, is the fact that Perez has been more effective with combinations. But it's not as if Agbeko isn't throwing combos, and there was two of them.
No let up whatsoever.
Perez was very distressed by Agbeko saying, knock him out. Wow.
Big right hand there by Agbeko. A resounding right.
And Perez is fighting as if he's trying to show he can't be knocked out by Agbeko.
Yeah, he's fighting as if to say, so you think you could knock me out, Joseph? Oh, what a left hand. Did you see what happened to the head of Agbeko there? It almost spun around.
And you know, Joseph Agbeko's fighting technically the best fight I've seen him fight. He's not lunging, he's throwing his punches with good form. And with it all, he's got his hands full and then some with Yanni Perez.
It really is a tremendous scenario that's unfolding here.
This This is just great action, and what I love about this fight is that technique has not gone out the window, even in a firefight.
Yeah, it's not sloppy.
No.
More punches landing by Perez. Agbeko coming back. Another left.
Time.
Perez. And they continue to swat away right up to the bell.
You need to fight with your head. You're coming out directly to him. With your hands, they're not up.
I got it, Danny.
All right, let's breathe.
The combination punching for Yanni Perez has been very, very effective, and it was the combination that kind of won the day in this sequence, because the hook missed and then the right hand followed it by Perez as he uses multiple punches to get the job done. Agbeko, though, throwing that right hand from a good posture, not lunging in with the punch, and that's been something he's done before. The Perez left hook that we just saw, to me, is the headline of this fight. Who knew he could throw that punch that effectively?
That was a stunning punch out, and it really got the attention of Agbeko. Now remember, Agbeko, who just landed with two lefts, is so durable.
Yes.
And Perez gets stronger as fights go on, so my goodness. Round three was fought mostly in the center of the ring. Here's Press Row through the first three, 29-28 across the board.
It's exactly the way I have it. I gave Press two of the first three rounds. Very close rounds, though, of course.
Press Row giving Agbeko the last round, where big punches were being thrown from everywhere.
You know, you would have thought the jab was going to be the most important weapon for Yanni Perez. It hasn't been. He's thrown jabs, but he's put himself in punching room to where the uppercut, the left hook, straight rights like that, clubbing rights are the punches he's using more. Agbeko's starting to lunge a little more, and he's starting to open himself up.
And when he does lunge and bends in, he makes himself susceptible to an uppercut. We'll see if Perez is cognizant of that. Going to the body is Perez. Back comes Agbeko. Here's the answer from Perez. Agbeko now going to the jab. Combination to the head, beautifully done by Perez. Then he nails him to the body, does Perez.
You know, Perez has gone downstairs a lot, and so has Agbeko. So we talk about this as a fight of attrition. And who will have done the best body work early? That's another question.
And in this fight, should get to the later rounds, that's when it really gets interesting. Because can Agbeko outwork Perez down the stretch and beat him on points with a minute left in round four?
Agbeko does not believe Perez can fight with him like this for a whole fight. He just doesn't think that. He thinks his power will ultimately get to Perez, but so far, Perez is hanging in there very well. It's a very, very close and competitive and fun fight.
Little or no lulls whatsoever in this fight through the first three-plus rounds. Good body work by Perez. Great fight here, hopefully a great fight November 21st with this break of the action. A look at the Super 6 World Boxing Classic, which continues in November.
There's only one way to determine the greatest super middleweight. Take the six best and have them face each other until there is one man standing. The tournament began with Arthur Abraham's knockout win over Jermaine Taylor and Carl Froch's split decision over Andre Durrell. Now group stage one concludes as WBA champion Mikel Kessler faces undefeated phenom Andre Ward. The Super 6 World Boxing Classic continues Saturday, November 21st at 10, only on Showtime.
And now Kessler, one of the co-favorites with Arthur Abraham, super confident as he comes into Ward's hometown.
Yeah, it'll be a big crowd in Oakland to root on Andre Ward, and we can't wait for that. I just think it's going to be a very exciting and interesting fight, and I think that describes what we're seeing tonight.
Round five, scheduled for 12, the IBF Bantamweight Championship, and it is a thriller, a Halloween thriller.
The fight redeeming the walkout, I guess, we hope.
Perez in the white trunks, the challenger, Agbeko in the black trunks with the silver trim, the champion. Here's Perez pinning Agbeko on the ropes. Agbeko punches his way out, goes to the body, goes upstairs. Back comes a right hand by Perez. The punches just never stop. Straight right hand, right on the button by Perez.
There's the head movement back, Agbeko, and he's very adept at that. He's been hit with a lot of punches here, certainly, and landed a lot as well. But there's the head movement. He doesn't keep his hands high, so he relies on that head movement. You know what's changed about this fight a little bit, Steve? The body work of Agbeko. In the last round and a half, he's done much more of it.
And just now, he was warned by Robert Byrd to keep the punches up. He may have strayed a little south.
He's the stablemate of Joshua Clotty, managed by the same gentleman, Vincent Scalpino, and trained by Adamo Addy. And they're very good friends. And both of them give you the same work ethic of three great minutes of every round.
Addy's trained Agbeko since the amateurs. Good straight right by Agbeko.
They are both landing some astonishing punches in this fight.
And you made a great point about the upper body movement. That was very successful against Darchinian. One of the ways he threw Darchinian off balance. And perhaps he's thinking, hey, maybe I got to go back to that, do more of that here against Perez. But nothing seems to be working.
Well, and Perez has been very accurate with his punches. It's not that Agbeko's not making him slip. The body work of Agbeko in this round, I feel bad. And Robert Byrd's a terrific referee, but I hope that doesn't discourage Agbeko from going to the body, because those were a little marginal, and I think, you know, he's not trying to go low there.
Well, one more, and he could be deducted a point. All this action, and there's still around 30 seconds left in the round. Now there's that upper body movement, the head and the shoulders always in motion from Agbeko. Boy, Perez just startling Agbeko, standing right in front of him and duking it out with the champion. He thought he'd be standing back and going from a distance. Not the case.
This is what you have to do. Get some more air right now. Get your air, the one that you need. When you block, then you have to go with the combination. Can you hear me? You're not throwing one.
Both men have landed superb right hands. At the same time, no less, in the last round, and Agbeko gets the last word in with his right, but no, another right hand would get in by Perez. This is where, that one did stray maybe a smidge. That was the first one on the belt line. It may have sprayed a little low. And then later on, they had a great exchange. Both men just continuing to throw. The Agbeko right hand a little sharper. And the body work of Agbeko, very, very well done in that round. And I think the difference in that round.
There's an old boxing expression, Al, toe-to-toe action. And that's what we have been seeing throughout. None of these guys taking a round off, taking a second off in this fight.
You mentioned that Perez started his pro career late at 26 because of a military duty. He had a brilliant amateur career. And he feels like it's his time to get that world championship. He knows his biological clock is ticking in boxing a little bit. And at age 30, he feels great urgency to win here tonight. And he's fighting now.
got that late start at 26, as you said, seven and a half years in the military, just shy of becoming a sergeant when he turned to boxing.
You know, the last round, Perez let Agbeko just a little bit take the play away from him. In this round, it's almost as if Perez came out and said, I know I may have let that last one slip away from me. I better make something happen. And he has been very good offensively here in the early part of this round.
Perez working that jab. Good left-right combination. Four-punch combination. There's another three-punch combination by Perez. He's working it.
Great performance by both men, really. And Perez in this round has been dazzling.
Looking so confident and sharp, Perez in the white.
And look at what just a little movement does for him. When he moves laterally, it gives Agbeko some issues.
And again, Agbeko targeting the body. Perez with the jab. And that's a weapon right there. That's not a rangefinder. Good right hand set up by the jab for Perez.
Both these men are dedicated to boxing. They both train in the U.S., have to leave their families back in their respective countries. Ghana, of course, for Agbeko, and Colombia for Perez. And they make sacrifices because they want to be champions. Agbeko is. And we can see that in what they're doing here tonight. These are two dedicated professionals.
And Perez sends 95% of his earnings back home to Colombia, South America, for his wife and kids.
And in California, it's tough to live on that 5%.
Good point. Nice uppercut on the inside by Agbeko.
The first good punch of this round, really, for Agbeko in terms of a real power punch. As good as round five was for Agbeko, that's how good round six has been for Perez.
Here comes Agbeko pushing Perez back to the ropes. That's where he spent a lot of time against Mabuza, but he was very effective off the ropes, Perez, hurting Mabuza.
The combination punching of Perez has been amazing. This will be a four-punch combination. He just has been very effective with that. He'll start with the jab, and then there'll be three punches following. Now, not everything landed. Actually, there's a one to the body to boot. But that's what keeps Joseph Agbeko at bay. Agbeko, at the end of the round, had a couple of very good moments, pushing Perez against the ropes, but then Perez counters often. But by and large, a very good round for Yanni Perez.
And now, during the course of that action, an accidental headbutt by Agbeko on the forehead of Perez.
So that was ruled an accidental headbutt.
Yes.
All right. Well,
they were working on the cut in the Perez corner.
So if this fight would be stopped because of that cut, they would go to the scorecards.
That is the rule after the end of round four. We're in seven, scheduled for 12. The IBF Bantamweight Championship, it has been blistering action.
Now that was what the Perez people were very worried about, but he brought that on himself. He's fighting on the inside. If you do that against Agbeko, it could happen. Agbeko is energized in this round and having a great first minute of round seven.
And as Agbeko comes on, let's take another peek at Press Row. One has it even, Ryan Bates. Press Row judges have it a majority decision to this point for Perez.
I have it dead even in this fight. That clash of heads and, you know, the same promotional group that handles Darchinian handles Yanni Perez, and they feel the Darchinian fight turned a bit because of clashes of heads. This fight has turned because of that clash of heads. There's no question Agbeko is energized in this round and doing better.
And as you were saying that, Al, Agbeko landed a good right hand to the head of Perez. Solid shot. Amazing pace to this fight.
Perez's punches lack a little of the steam of the last round. He's throwing a little wider with those punches with less intensity.
Well, in the fight buildup, Agbeko insists. Oh. Look out, there goes the head again, right, Al?
Yeah, and I tell you, that one looked kind of intentional by Joseph Agbeko. Is there such a thing as kind of intentional?
Well, kind of. He does have a habit of bending the rules from time to time, with his head mostly. But before the fight, he said, ultimately, Perez will not be able to take his punches for 12 rounds. We'll see. The thing is, can Perez take the head of Agbeko for 12 rounds?
See how the punches by Perez are pushed a little bit more. They're not as sharp as they were.
Agbeko in phenomenal physical condition. Perez in great condition too, but seems like Agbeko has a little more energy here in round 7.
Johnny, Johnny, tú necesitas pelear tu pelea, okay? Lo tenía que decir. Siéntate en la derecha.
You gotta sit. You gotta sit on this sleeve that you have. Let me work on it. It's
good. Let me work on it. In round 6, what opened the cut over Yanni Perez's eye was this clash of heads. Well, the head is down, as you can see, for Agbeko. He's kind of charging in like a bull. And he took some punches for his trouble, but ultimately we believe that's where the cut was landed or created. Then in round 7, what looked like a kind of a blatant use of the head, and I would say it was a blatant use of the head, that was more to the mouth of Yanni Perez, and he had a moment where he wanted to get Robert Byrd's attention over that one.
As we mentioned earlier, Perez's promoter, Gary Shaw, extremely concerned about what he would characterize as a third fist, the head of Agbeko.
It's had an impact in other fights, that's for sure, and is having one in this fight as well.
Round 8, scheduled for 12, the IBF Bantamweight Championship. The champion, Joseph King Kong Agbeko, in the black trunks with the silver trim. The challenger, Yanni Perez, the number one contender, undefeated in the white trunks. It has been a stirring affair.
Get off his neck.
Wide left hook that scored for Agbeko.
You know, an important point, in Perez's corner, they think he's ahead in this fight, for sure. And they think it's a real lead. When they said sit on your lead, they're saying box a little more, try and protect yourself a bit, which I don't think is a bad idea, even if he's not, doesn't have a big lead.
Yeah, let's see if he starts doing what Agbeko expected him to do early on.
Now, interestingly, he has not followed his corner's advice. Perez has gone right after Agbeko and isn't doing that bad in this round.
And he's pushing Agbeko back.
So go figure.
He's trying to pin him in the corner.
Agbeko almost looks like he's trying to lure Perez in.
Yeah, sort of an Arthur Abraham strategy.
Yeah. The only thing is he doesn't put his hands up like Abraham.
Yeah.
You're kind of supposed to block those punches.
Exactly. There is a minor difference.
And Perez is having a very good 8th round. This fight is very difficult. The last 4 rounds have been bizarre. Each man has dominated one of the last 4 rounds.
It's an intriguing fight.
And just when you thought Perez was on the downslide, he comes back with a very good first 2 minutes of round 8. See if it can continue.
Minute to go in the 8th. If you're just tuning in, it has been like this from the opening bell. Relentless action. Look at it.
Big right hand in that sequence by Perez. Agbeko giving some good shots as well. Now, is this flurry by Agbeko enough to get him back in this round? Will the judges remember the last minute instead of the first 2 minutes?
Right up. Great camera work
action. From the point of view of Perez as he tries to fend off Joseph Egbeko. Unbelievable action. Yanni Perez at a place he doesn't want to be, against the ropes, trying to counter off those ropes as Egbeko attacks. See how dangerous the Egbeko head is in there when he's close by. He comes up with his head, and there's always the danger of a clash of heads. But that was a good last sequence in the round for Egbeko. The first 2 minutes were very good for Perez, so what do the judges remember from that fight? Or that round, I should say.
Two warriors get set for round 9, scheduled for 12. So here we are in the later rounds, where, as we pointed out a few rounds ago, things could get mighty interesting.
We should point out that Perez is 1-0 in 12-round fights, and a 4-3-1 record, I believe, for a 4-1 record for Egbeko. Only lost to Sidorenko, who, by the way, is in the building here tonight, former champion in this weight division.
Vladimir Sidorenko in 0-4, and that was a majority decision.
Yeah, very close fight that could have gone Egbeko's way. Now, the last four rounds, I mentioned, each man has dominated one of those rounds. Will this one be closer? Perez with some huge combinations there.
Looks like Perez has sort of regained his composure here.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. After that, in round 7, it looked like he was very discouraged because of that cut.
Sort of has a second win now.
Well, that's the thing that marks both these men as fighters. They're very resilient, they have a lot of grit, and they have no quit in them.
Another look at press row scoring. Our panel sees it this way. Two guys have it for Perez by 2 points. And let's see, Ryan Bates has Egbeko by 2 points. It's a split.
And I am splitting the difference because I still have it even.
Wow. This is fun tonight.
Watch your head, watch your head.
Egbeko getting his right hand in better in the last, during this round than he was in the last one.
Well, they said it would be an entertaining fight, and it lived up to billing. How can it not be with these two guys?
We already knew who Joseph Egbeko was from the win over Darchini. We've seen him win his title here on Showtime. Yanni Perez, not, as you said, not exactly a household name, but respected in boxing circles. People should know who he is now. He's a good, good, good bantamweight.
Showbox alum. You know, no matter who wins this fight, doesn't matter. They both won us over. Final seconds, round 9.
Bell, got a bell, got a bell, got a bell, bell. That's another headbutt, ref.
Let me work on it. Let me work on it. Let me work on it.
You're doing well.
Hey.
You have them, but you're not finishing. You're not finishing with the combination. You hit him and then you stop. You just gotta keep going. Hit him in the jaw.
Yes.
Hit all night.
No te preocupes. Tú usas las manos.
to use the hands.
Their body. One of the little. See, straight punch is you need fine. So, Jabu, come on. All right, what's your name? Come on.
You saw the cut on Perez's forehead. As we get ready for round 10, Perez 19-0 with 14 knockouts. And Beko 27-1, 22 KOs.
And about that cut, the way where that cut is, more on the forehead area, that could not come from anything but a clash of heads. So that kind of, you know, validates the decision by Robert Byrd.
And with a guy like Ed Beko, to be expected.
But it has not been a major factor now in terms of the confidence of Perez or anything. Good right hand by Ed Beko. Ooh, and another.
Right on the top of the head. Good jab by Ed Beko.
Watch your head, guys. Watch your head. Okay, let's go.
Robert Byrd on top of it. Solid Las Vegas referee.
You know, the left hook of Perez that was so good earlier, now not so good. And he's not known for that punch. That's why it was so amazing that he was landing it so precisely and so powerfully early. But now he's kind of pushing that punch and throwing it too wide. Ed Beko having a very good round 10.
Good right hand by Ed Beko. Now he goes to the body. Again to the midsection, Ed Beko. He's really starting to land more punches repeatedly.
Perez's shots are wider and less effective than they were early in this fight. You don't want to make a judgment too early, but here in round 10, you get the feeling.
And a right by Perez.
Well, I was just going to say, you get the feeling Perez is really slowing down. Then he lands two great rights.
Then out of nowhere, he sneaks one in. These guys really have to respect one another. I mean, Ed Beko said that even when he was dismissive. In terms of predicting the knockout. He said, P.S., I think Perez is a great fighter. Now he's really finding out. His words are true.
Good jab by Ed Beko. Punch that is sometimes underused.
Uh-oh, look out! Something with the eye of Ed Beko, and he goes down. It's being ruled a knock. Down with 30 seconds to go. He gets up quickly.
Seven,
he says it was a headbutt.
Eight, you okay? You want to go?
There's a twist.
He said
Perez butted him, and he is upset in the direction of Robert Byrd.
I think there was a clash of heads, but Robert Byrd didn't see it, and Perez kept punching.
So a dramatic moment, a poignant moment in this fight.
Time,
and that's the first time that Beko is down in his career.
Okay, relax.
Turn your back. Much of the drama of this fight has revolved around clashes of heads. Now, we believe that's what started this sequence and created the problem for Ed Beko. We'll find out in a moment, because it's much easier to see in slow motion, but it looked that way in fast motion as well. There it is. That's the head that, and he just turned. And then Perez did the right thing. The referee didn't step in, and so he said, I'll keep punching. Now, Robert Byrd was on the other side of this, so there's a reason why he couldn't see that. He's kind of in back of the two fighters, and it just wasn't obvious to him. And it became a knockdown.
Al, I think it was right on his eye, and it temporarily blinded him.
And you point out the irony of the fact that more often those kind of situations go in Ed Beko's benefit. I want to point out that would not be a situation covered by the new rule where they'd go to instant replay. It is only if a fight is stopped as a result of something untoward that happens at that moment, if it stopped at that moment.
All right, Al, so the plot thickens as we hit the championship round.
Well, the only thing missing from this fight was controversy, and now we have that as well.
Another look at press row scoring. Things continue to get interesting. Two have it, Perez, one Agbeko.
And the question was, would you make that last round a 10-8 round because Agbeko was doing very well in it?
So, of course, that's unofficial. They've got it a split decision for the challenger, Perez, in the white. Now Perez, with the hands down, has to be careful. Cannot toy with Agbeko.
And we have to give Agbeko a lot of credit. That hurt him, that clash of heads. That hurt him badly, and he went down, and he's recovered relatively well from that.
He got up pretty quickly, but he was stunned momentarily.
Now, Perez now throwing a lot of those combinations that he even threw earlier, but Perez's punches, make no mistake about it, don't have the same steam they had earlier in the fight. And Agbeko was winning that last round. Oh, my!
The action. The action just rages on.
And now, such a sense of urgency by Agbeko because of that knockdown. Whether he thinks it was legitimate or not, he knows it went against him.
Oh, it could be a huge factor down the stretch if this goes to the scorecards. We come up on a minute remaining in the 11th round. The drama builds. Oh, Perez just got out of the way of that one. Left hook, sweeping hook attempt by Agbeko. Back comes Perez on the inside.
Steve, they exchanged two right hands that should have knocked anybody down. Both men threw them.
The durability of these two warriors. And, you know, I don't want to sound redundant by keep saying they're warriors, but they are gallant.
And there's body work by Agbeko, not forgetting that. This round was a round that Agbeko was doing very well in early, but Perez has come back exceptionally well in the last minute and a half.
It's as if it's the first round, the way they're throwing.
This is one of those fights I don't want it to end. I know nobody should have to take more than 12 rounds of this, but I don't want it to end.
I'm sure a lot of fans share the same feeling. Final seconds of the 11th, another sizzling round from Las Vegas.
Hey, it's Johnny, you're real close. This is the last round coming. This is the last round, 12th round. You gotta take the title. You came here. That's what you came here for. You came to take it away. Your hands have to be up. And discipline. And this is for all the sacrifice you've done for your family. All right, go for it. The final round of a brilliant championship fight here in Las Vegas. And how about the two symmetrical cuts on the inside of Perez's eyebrow?
And I believe the second one was caused in the last round or the round before when Agbeko went down from that clash of heads.
Here we go, Al.
Everything's on the line here in round 12. We don't know what the official scoring is, but you have to think this is a very close fight.
Non-stop, relentless punching by both fighters. Oh. Perez landing with the right hand and the left. What does Agbeko have? Uppercut of the inside with the left hand by Perez. Agbeko to the body with the left.
I would be shocked if the judges have this more than a point or two or one way or the other. I've got 1 point for Perez. Easily make a case for Joseph Agbeko.
I don't
Easily.
Know if I've ever called a fight in about 22 years with this many punches.
No, Steve, I think you're right. The work rate has been ridiculous. And the big punches landed have been ridiculous. Both men are good punchers.
This is out of sight.
And some of the big punches have come so quickly. Look at that little left hook on the inside by Perez and then the right by Agbeko. There are so many punches, you lose sight of the big ones.
One of the great fights of 2009. You're seeing it right here on Showtime.
The Agbeko right hand effective in this round. The Neither man has slowed his attack in round 12. Not at all.
The fans chanting Yanni, Yanni. The underdog, Yanni Perez. What a sensational fight this has been.
If you stand in front of Joseph Ekpeko and fight him, you will get a great fight. And that's what Yanni Perez has done, and it has been a great fight.
One of the true crowd-pleasing fights in a long time. Coming up on 30 seconds left in this Halloween thriller. Really living up to its billing. And then some. Seconds to go in a fabulous affair. Non-stop action from the opening bell to the closing bell. It is now in the judges' hands. Ekpeko didn't get the knockout he predicted. Now he hopes and prays for the win.
You said it best earlier, Steve. I'm not sure there's a loser in this fight. Of course, it makes a big difference, two wins, a championship that goes with it that man wanted badly and this man has. But both men made a statement for themselves tonight in that they're in the upper echelon of boxers.
Perez being paraded around the ring on his handler's shoulders with a little bit of a victory parade, but we shall see.
In the last round, they fought like it was the first round, throwing body punches, ripping on the inside, as active as you could possibly be in a 12. That was that little short left hook, followed by the left hook of Ekpeko. All these little short punches on the inside, very, for the most part, very forceful. And both men were able to sustain through the big punches that were landed by the other man. Look at that hook and the right hand. Those are knockout punches that are being landed by these two men. Short, compact, good punches, and they didn't go anywhere, either of them. I don't even think either man was hurt in this fight or in a situation where they were close to going down.
I don't think I'm being unrealistic, as now they hoist Ekpeko up in the air in victory. I don't think I'm being unrealistic to say this has to be considered as a candidate for fight of the year.
Yeah, in a year, 2009, that has had many candidates.
Certainly in the upper echelon.
Pick it up, nice
and still.
What a great fight.
Come on, man, you know we won that fight. And still. Come on, you know we won that fight.
One of the stories in this fight, the headbutts. Let's go inside the ropes with that in mind.
And the operative word is where the headbutts or clashes of heads. We'll look and decide. There they are, banging heads on the inside. And these kinds of clashes would ultimately open up two cuts on the forehead of Yanni Perez, but that created a knockdown in the fight. So that may have been the most important one, because Ekpeko went down ostensibly from the clash of heads, even though there were punches afterwards.
Well, we are set for the official announcement. Let's get it up to our ring announcer, Jimmy Lennon Jr.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I read our score totals, we've all seen an outstanding world championship attraction. No matter who the winner is, they both deserve a round of applause. Yanni Perez and Joseph Ekpeko. Well, fans, after 12 rounds of action, we have a unanimous decision. Here are the score totals. Judge at ringside, Jerry Roth scores the bout 116 to 111. Judges Glenn Trowbridge and Barry Druxman both score the bout 117 to 110. All three in favor of the winner. And the new IBF Bantamweight Champion of the World, Yanni Perez.
Yanni Perez by unanimous decision and by some wide margin.
I guess if there's anything about that decision that would ring strangely, it would be the margin. Of course, Joseph Agbeko in a state of shock. We thought the fight was a little closer than that, but clearly the work rate of Yanni Perez is what won the day for him. And all that work rate plus the knockdown, whether it was appropriate or not, if you put all that together, apparently the judges' minds, they thought it was a little farther apart than we did.
And how about the expression on the face of the former champion, Joseph Agbeko?
I had Perez winning by 2 points in this fight, but...
Let's go back down to the knockdown and the headbutt in round 10.
Now, this created a little more of the swing and scoring, where the two men came together, and it was the head of Perez that really created the issue. Now, we should say, in all fairness, as we look at this, that more often than not during the course of his career, Joseph Agbeko has kind of gotten the benefit of those clashes of heads himself. However, doesn't negate the fact that that's unquestionably what scored the knockdown. And let me tell you something else. That created a knockdown in a round in which Agbeko was doing very well. So there was a swing there. However, that having been said, you don't need to say that Yanni Perez shouldn't have won this fight, because he could easily have, even though if we might wonder about the margins. The fact of the matter is Perez was very active and landed a lot of power shots as well.
All right, Al, this should be interesting. Let's get it up into the ring right now for post-fight reaction and our Jim Gray. Jim?
All right, Steve, thank you very much. We will talk to both fighters. First, the new champion, Yanni, congratulations to you. Did you feel as though you had won this fight by as big a margin as the judges did?
Felicidades, Johnny. ¿Tú pensaste que ganaste la pelea por el margen que te dieron los jueces?
Bueno, sí, yo pienso de que fue una decisión justa, ya de que yo sea Beco un gran peleador, fue una gran pelea. Le doy gracias a Dios, a mis promotores, a mi padre, a mi entrenador. Y aquí estamos para defender este título por mucho tiempo y voy a mirarme por ahora mucho más.
He says that it was the right decision, that Agbeko is a great fighter, but that he felt he was ahead by that point what the judges gave him.
How concerned were you after you sustained that cut over your eye from the accidental headbutt in the sixth round?
Cuando pasó el headbutt accidentalmente, ¿cómo estabas tú? ¿Pensabas que iban a parar la pelea?
No, no pensé. Sí, sentí en el momento que me pegó el cabezazo y me partió, y luego acá en la otra. Pero mi esquina siempre me decía, calmado, calmado, que estás bien. Y en cada round me sentía más sereno.
I definitely felt the headbutt, but my corner kept telling me, be calm, just keep fighting.
Agbeko said before the fight that he would knock you out. You told me in the pre-fight interview that he can talk a lot, but he won't be able to back it up. Did those words by him throughout the week annoy you?
Agbeko dijo que te iba a noquear. ¿Eso te molestó durante la semana que él te había dicho eso?
No, no me molestó. De hecho, me alegró porque yo quería probarle que no iba a ser así como lo hice. Y gracias le doy a Showtime por esta oportunidad y espero que me vuelva a tener nuevamente en cuenta aquí en Shujo para brindarle un espectáculo como esto.
No, it didn't bother me. Just give me more strength to fight Agbeko. And he thanks Showtime for the fight and hopes for another opportunity.
For another opportunity, let me ask him about that. Steve Albert and Al Bernstein, who've been calling fights for an awful long time, said they have never seen this many punches thrown in a fight. Does that make this worthy of a rematch? Will he grant a rematch?
Steve y Al, los comentadores dicen que nunca han visto tantas trompadas como el día de hoy. ¿Qué tú piensas de esta pelea?
Bueno, de que yo sea Beco un gran peleador, yo también soy un gran peleador. Nos preparamos para tirar miles y miles de golpes, cantidad de golpes. Y este triunfo se lo dedico a Santa Fe Spring, que hay que votar por José Ángel Zamora, el futuro alcalde, para la prosperidad de Santa Fe Spring.
He, of course, dedicates his fight to Santa Fe Springs. I guess somebody that's also Joel Zamora, who's out there trying to win some.
About the rematch.
La revancha. ¿Quiere una revancha?
Bueno, cuando él quiera, aquí yo estoy presto para eso.
Whenever he wants it, I'm here for him.
All All right, congratulations. I know there'll be a big celebration in Colombia. Congratulations to you.
Gracias a toda la gente que me vio, a Sean Tang y a mis amigos ahí en Santa Fe Spring, Alfredo, a toda su familia, a la familia Zamora.
He thanks all those friends in Santa Fe for this victory.
All right, muchas gracias. Now let's move in with King Kong Agbeko. Joseph, did you think you won the fight?
Yeah, I believe I won this fight. You know, I'm the champion and I fought as a champion. And during the round, I had a headbutt and the referee has to count me as a knockdown. And I think I deserve to win this fight.
Let's take a look at that 10th round when you thought that you were headbutt, and in fact you were. The referee did not call it. However, you broke the cardinal rule by not defending yourself at all time. Why didn't you continue to fight until you saw the referee step in?
Yeah, when I had a headbutt, I felt like there was blood coming. That was why I had to stop, and the referee has to count me.
In the end, do you feel as though that moment really made, as we take a look at it right there? You stopped fighting, however.
It was clear there, and you can see that it was a headbutt.
Why did you stop fighting?
Yeah, because when he hit the headbutt, I thought the referee saw me, and I felt like the blood was coming. That was why I had to stop.
All right. Do you want a rematch because of what you feel is disputed?
Yeah, I think I won this fight, and they gave it to me because I don't think the decision is fair, and I want a rematch.
Okay, Joseph, we appreciate your time.
Thank you.
All right, let's bring in Don King right now. Don, it was a terrific night. We saw some good fights here this evening. And you think there should be a rematch?
It should be a rematch because I don't agree with the judges' decision. However, they made their decision. I think a rematch would be great. And I think it was a great evening of boxing here for Phil Ruffin in the Treasure Island Arena.
And I know there's something that you've wanted to say for a couple of months now, so here's the opportunity. Go ahead.
Yes, it's for Tommy Kimmins. You know, I was in the heat of passion, and I said some things that I shouldn't have said, so I want to apologize to Tommy Kimmins.
That's the referee from a fight?
That's the referee from the fight with Adagio and Antonio DeMarco.
All right, Don, thank you very much. We saw a picture this evening, everybody, I didn't think we'd ever see again. It was a throwback to a day gone by when we saw Don King and Mike Tyson. Great evening, Steve. Back to you.